Hello everyone, welcome you all in the session 3 of the topic Micromeritics and Powder Rheology. In our previous sessions, we have discussed a lot about the particle size, fundamental properties of the particles, their derived properties, and several techniques by which we can determine the particle size. So in continuation with that only, now we are discussing about the sedimentation technique and the conductivity method by which we can determine the particle size. So first, we discuss about the sedimentation technique by which we can determine the particle size. In this method, the particle size can be determined by examining the powder as it sediment out. So firstly, we have to prepare a sample for this technique. So for sample preparation, the powder is dispersed in a suitable solvent. And if the powder has a hydrophobic nature, then it may be necessary to avoid to add some dispersing agent to aid wetting of the powder. In case if the powder is soluble in water, then it is very necessary to use non-aqueous type of liquid or carry out the analysis in gas. So the principle of the measurement by sedimentation technique is that particle size analysis is done on the basis of sedimentation of the particle in a suspension or the slurry which we have prepared during sample preparation. It can be divided into two main categories. The first one is the type of the measurement of particle in a retention zone, and the other type is use of a non-retention measurement. Okay, so the Andreessen pipette method, which is the most common one method used for sedimentation technique, is completely based on non-retention measurement zone. So here is the Andreessen pipette method. It is one of the most popular method developed by Andreessen and Lundberg, and it is commonly called as the Andreessen pipette. In this method, a calculated volume of suspension are drawn off and the concentration differences are measured with respect to time. It involves the measuring of the percentage of solid that settles with time in a graduated vessel. So the construction of the Andreessen pipette is such that it has a graduated cylinder of 200 mm of diameter, and it can hold about 500 ml of the suspension fluid. A pipette is located centrally in the cylinder and it is held in such a position so that it can touch the ground level ground glass stopper so that its tip can coincide with the zero level. A three-way tap allows the fluid to be drawn out into a 10 ml reservoir, which can then be emptied into a beaker or the centrifuge tube further for the collection of the powder. Then the method which we use for sedimentation technique by Andreessen pipette is 1% suspension of the powder in a suitable medium is made, and then it is placed in the pipette. At a given particular time of interval, the samples are withdrawn from a specified depth without disturbing the suspension. The amount of powder can be determined by weight following the drying or centrifuging. Alternatively, chemical analysis of the particle can also be carried out to determine the amount of powder. The particle size is determined by using Stokes diameter. Basically, the Stokes law is completely dependent on the sedimentation, and it allows the users to identify the sedimentation rate of the powder. So the diameter of a particle can be measured during sedimentation at a constant rate by using this modified Stokes equation. Here in this equation, DST is equals to 18 eta h whole upon rho s minus rho f fgt, where DST is the Stokes diameter, eta is the viscosity of the medium, h is the sedimentation height, rho s minus rho f is the differences in the density of particle and the fluid, fg is the force of gravity, and t is the sedimentation time. The data of the cumulative weight is used for the further determination of particle weight distribution and number distribution, etc. So it is all about the sedimentation technique by which we can determine the particle size. So the main advantages of this technique is that the apparatus is not costly and the technique is very simple, and the result obtained by this technique are precise in nature. Then when we talk about the disadvantages, very small particle size cannot be determined accurately. The method is laborious since separate analysis are required for each experimental point on the distribution curve. So that's all about sedimentation technique. Now we come on to our next technique, that is conductivity technique. There are various subtypes, and two most popular methods in conductivity technique are electrical stream sensing zone method, which we commonly known as cooler counter method, and the second one is the laser light scattering method. So because the cooler counter method is the most popular one, so we discuss about it here only. The electrical stream sensing zone, that is cooler counter method, and this method is used for particle volume measurement. When a particle suspended in a conducting liquid passes through a small orifice on either side of which are electrode, a change in electric resistance occur, and this electric resistance is measured in this technique only. So about sample preparation, the powder samples are dispersed in an electrolyte to form a very dilute suspension, and then this suspension is subjected to a ultrasonic agitation to break up any particle lumps. A dispersant may also be added so that we can avoid the agglomerates which can be formed in the suspensions which are made as sample. Then conductivity technique, the particles sample or suspension is drawn through an aperture accurately drilled through a sapphire crystal set into the wall of a hollow glass tube. The electrodes are situated on either side of the apparatus. Here we can see these electrodes. This is the orifice, and we put our electrolyte solution and our particles here. The electrode solution is filled up from here, and electrodes on the either side of the aperture are surrounded by an electrolyte solution. These electrode monitors change in the electric signal which occur when a particle momentarily occupies the orifice and displaces its own volume of electrolyte. The volume of electrolyte fluid which is displaced in the orifice by the presence of a particle causes a change in electrical resistance between the electrode, which is proportional to the volume of the particle, and the volume of the particle can be identified easily. Then the advantage of this conductivity technique is that particle size ranging from 0.5 to 500 micron can be easily identified by this method. It gives number distribution, particle volume measurement, and can be converted to diameter also. This method is accurate, sensitive, and a very fast technique. Around 4,000 particles per second can be counted by using this technique. Large number of particles can also be counted. The diameter of the sphere of equivalent volume can be easily calculated. The process is very rapid, with a single taking of less than 30 seconds. When we talk about the disadvantages of this technique, the material has to be suspended in an electrolyte liquid before measurement. The aggregation of particle can give several false results, and obviously the technique is very expensive in nature. So that's all about the particle size and its determination technique. Now we move on to the particle shape. Particle shape also influences the surface area, the flow properties, the packing, and the compaction of the particle. Several spherical particles have minimum surface area, and that's why they are having a better flow properties. Shape can also have influence on the rate of dissolution of the drug. So the technique which we use for the determination of particle shapes are the microscopy and the light scattering technique, which we had discussed earlier. The shapes we have are acicular shape, which are needle shaped particles. Then we can have some angular type of crystals also, or particles also, which are sharp edged. Then crystalline, like geometrical in nature, dendritics, which are branched crystalline shape, then granular, equidimensional, irregular shapes, spherical, and the global shape. Then we move on to the particle surface area. So what is the specific surface? First, we have to know about that. The surface area per unit volume, or we can say the surface area per unit weight, is known as the specific surface area. Surface area is an important parameter, as the bioavailability of the certain drug is dependent on surface area, because as the surface area increases, the intimate contact between your API and its solvent also increases, and hence dissolution increases, which results in the increased bioavailability of that particular API. Then we have two methods which we use generally for the determination of surface area. The first method is the amount of gas or liquid solute adsorbed on the sample of a powder to form a monolayer. That is the adsorption method. And the second method is the rate at which the gas or liquid permeates a bed of powder. That is the air permeability method. So here we discuss one by one about the adsorption method and the air permeability method. So firstly, the adsorption method. This method is basically dependent on the complete theorem of Brunner and Emmett, theory of adsorption. So a large surface area allows good adsorption of gas or solute from a solution. The volume of gas adsorbed per gram of adsorbent can be plotted against the pressure of gas introduced at constant temperature, and it is known as the adsorption isotherm. At low pressure, the gas adsorbs on the surface of the adsorbent and form a monolayer. So most substances adsorb a monomolecular layer of the gas under certain condition of partial pressure of gas and temperature. This is the theory of Brunner and Emmett. The adsorption process is carried out at liquid nitrogen temperature of about minus 196 degrees Celsius. And once the surface adsorption has reached to its equilibrium, the sample is heated so that to expel out the nitrogen gas which get adsorbed on the surface, and the volume of this nitrogen is then measured. As the nitrogen molecule occupies the fixed area, one can easily compute the surface area from the pre-weighed sample. Here is the Brunner-Emmett equation, that is P upon P in bracket P naught minus P is equals to 1 upon YMB is equals to B minus P whole upon YMB into P upon P naught, where P is the pressure of the adsorbate and P naught is the vapor pressure at saturation. Y is the volume of vapor per gram, YM is the amount of vapor adsorbed per unit mass of the adsorbent, and B is the constant. Here also we have provided a graph which is the adsorption isotherm showing the volume of the nitrogen gas adsorbed, and it is plotted against the pressure and the nitrogen adsorbed per gram into your sample. Then particle surface area determination by using air permeability method. In this method, the resistance offered to flow of liquid such as air through a plug of compact powder is proportional to the surface area of the powder. The greater the surface area per gram of the powder, the greater is the resistance to flow. And the instrument used for this determination is known as Fisher subsieve sizer. It consists of a sample tube which can contain your packed powder sample with one end connected to an air pump through a constant pressure regulator, and the other end is attached to a calibrated monometer containing a suitable liquid of low viscosity and negligible vapor pressure. The powder is packed in a sample holder. Here is our sample holder where we plug in our powder. Then packing appears as a series of capillaries, and air is allowed to pass through these capillaries at constant pressure. Here is our air pump, and this air pump is continuously supplying the air into the packed sample here. The function of dryer is to dry out the air if any mist or moisture content is present in this air, because it can interact with the powder and make it agglomerate, or lumps can be formed because of the moisture content of the air. So for avoiding this, we used a dryer here in front of the air pump. Now, resistance is created as air passes through capillaries, thus causing pressure drop. Greater the surface area, greater is the resistance, and air permeability is inversely proportional to the surface area. Here we are having a formula by which we can determine it. V is equals to A upon eta S square W into del PT upon K1 into eta 1 epsilon 1 upon, epsilon upon 1 minus epsilon square. That is, V is equals to volume of air flowing through the bed. A is the cross-sectional area of the bed. Eta is the viscosity of air. SW is the surface area per gram of the powder. Del P is the pressure difference of the plug. Epsilon is the porosity of the powder. And T is the time taken to flow. So that's all about the particle surface area determination by using both of the technique, that is our adsorption technique and the air permeability method. So we have talked a lot about the fundamental properties of the powder, which involves its particle size, particle number, particle volume, particle surface area, particle size distribution analysis, and we had discussed a lot about the techniques by which we can determine these fundamental properties. So that is all about the fundamental properties of the powder. So thank you all.